so tonight we're talking corporate structure and legal agreements. We've got Steve Saville and John Conlin, both from Fasken Martineau, with us today, and they'll walk you through it. I don't really have anything to describe because cap table, right? That's what everyone likes to. Everyone comes for. I'm going to quickly thank our sponsors and. And then I'll just pass it over to them. So our lead sponsor is BC Innovation Council. Our gold sponsors are Ernst & Young, Fasken, Martineau, Van City, and the Vancouver Economic Commission. Our silver sponsors are BCTIA, CDRD, SFU BD School of Business, UBC Cider School of Business, and Progressa. Our bronze sponsors are Acetec, VEF, Front Funder, Webnames.ca, and Pusher Media. And last reminder is, last two reminders. The washrooms are a bit far from here. If you go down the hall either way, you can look for the washroom signs. They're kind of spread out through the campus here. And we are webcasting, my usual reminder. So if you have a question, we do ideally want you to ask it into the microphone. So put up your hand and I'll come running with the microphone for you to ask your question. Thank you. Otherwise, I believe Steve and John are going to tag team it today. So over to both of you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
It sounds like my microphone's on, so hopefully everybody can hear just fine. We're going to start off introducing ourselves just so you know who's sitting in front of you here. My name's Steve Saville. I'm a partner in securities and M&A at Faskins. I started my career in Toronto, generally doing public company work there. I worked 2 years in England doing public company work and emerging markets work there, and moved to Vancouver in 2008, and I've been working in public and private company work in Vancouver. I came to Vancouver, as a public company lawyer, and I certainly discovered when I moved here what a vibrant private company market there is, and with lots of startups and lots of interesting business activity. And I certainly, when I saw that, I wanted to evolve my practice to ensure that I was participating in that. So really over the last 8 years, I'm probably doing almost 70-80% private company work, from startups I've done startups through to IPO, I've done startups through to major acquisitions. So you get to sort of see every stage of company and deal with the issues that people are dealing with when they're founding their company, dealing with interesting shareholders, interesting employees, all the different things. So seeing it right through to some sort of great exit for people. So that's my background. I'll pass it to John to talk about his.
Thanks, Steve. Yeah, I'm in my fifth year at Faskins. I've kind of grown up a bit more in exclusively the startup world, so working with a lot of people like yourselves. And so over the course of the last 5 years, I've had the opportunity to work with literally hundreds of startups, not just in the initial phases, but also taking them through the natural life cycle and in oftentimes a successful exit and a happy large dinner at the end. And so I do kind of live in this world a lot, I'll just add as an aside that it's definitely one of the more exciting areas of law to work in when you're thinking of whether you could go fight in court all day or help people with crazy ideas turn it into a success. It's fun. So obviously happy to give of our time and hopefully you get something out of this.
Let's go through. So normally when I tell people that I work at Fasken Martineau, and I should say that we're the biggest firm in Vancouver and we're a big firm across the country, but people that aren't in the business space or aren't accustomed to being sued have never heard of us other than that we're on the boards in front of the Canucks bench at the hockey games. So I'm not sure with the room here if people engaged lawyers, show of hands, been involved with lawyers for starting up a company, been involved with lawyers being sued, anything like that? Okay, more of those than startups, unfortunately. Generally speaking, and I always think, when I talk to these people, if they say, "Oh, I've never heard of the law firm," it's generally a good thing if you're sort of conducting the ordinary life of a citizen. But if you are getting into business and starting up a company, it's a really good thing to get to know law firms. And I think we're a really good one. We've got offices. Across 8 cities, we're all the big cities across Canada. We're in London and in Johannesburg as well. We've got 700 lawyers. Within Vancouver, we've got a full practice, so it's what we call the full service firm, where we can do the tax, we can do litigation, employment, corporate, all the different things people need. So it's one of the big diverse shops with a lot of great lawyers and really good teams. And John is going to tell us a little bit just about the technology group in particular in the startup group.
Yeah, so in kind of keeping with that theme, we're the largest tech group in the city. You know, if you're sitting there saying, you know, stop talking about yourselves, what does that matter to me? Really what it is a breadth of experience in this area, not only for the 15 of us that kind of live and breathe this every day, but also, you know, as part of the value add of the large firm is the related experts. So you are inevitably going to get employment, tax, litigation issues that arise. And I think as consumers of legal services, you know, ask yourself, you know, and it's totally fair to ask any potential lawyer that you might engage is to say, well, if I have this other issue, how are you going to help me there? Because, you know, things don't unfortunately fall into neat boxes in the world of being a founder and starting a company as far as the law is concerned. So, you know, the kind of core 15 of us, we do this every day. And certainly not only is it the small stuff, and as a large firm, you know, we're able to help. We're not just the big, bad, expensive law firm. We're able to help startups in a number of ways on that front. But also, you know, when you do sell your company for $1 billion and the paper is about 20 feet high, we're comfortable in that world too. So,
all right, moving along here. So it is what we're going to focus here is corporate structure and legal agreements. And well, I'm not sure. This is a first time for us doing this presentation in this crowd, so we're not 100% sure how familiar people are, so I think we're probably going to be doing a little back and forth to keep you engaged and also to sort of gauge experience. So we had a couple people that have incorporated a company before. I think I saw a couple hands. Why do people like incorporating companies? Does anybody want to shout that out for me? A couple of the good reasons for incorporating a company?
Limited liability.
That's a very good thing. So one of the things with a corporation, when you set it up, it's a separate legal entity. It's, you know, when it's not you that signs the contract, it's the corporation. It's not you that may be liable if something goes wrong, it's the corporation. The other thing that is really good for there's many things, quite frankly, but another really important thing is when you want to bring in investors, if they're not going to just want to give you personally money because they give it to you, that's your money. They need something that they can invest in and hold an interest in. And a corporation is a structure where it's set up where you can separate management and ownership can be divided into fractions, which are called shares, which I'm sure most of you know. And it's a structure that allows you to set up something on the side and say, this is the entity that's we're going to deal with. It's going to own the IP. It's going to own, you know, whatever the you know, the mousetrap is that we've built. And it's going to be the one that people invest in. And if anything goes wrong, it is the one that's responsible. So they're really for commerce. They're a beautiful thing. I'm sure we could have come up with a different way of doing things, but it's a really important structure that allows people with ideas to access capital, and that's what most startups need is some sort of structure where that somebody can come in and say that's. You know, not only is that a good idea, but that's a structure in which it makes sense to me. I can come in and invest. So it's one of the things that we often, you know, entrepreneurs struggle with, or it's just concepts that you have to get straight, I guess, is there's kind of a difference between running your business and running your corporation in the sense that the business is, you know, maybe I've built a better mousetrap. I've got a great idea. But you need to put the idea into a structure that's going to make sense, that can employ people, can execute contracts, can get investment from third parties, and that's running the corporation. And you sometimes see really good entrepreneurs that are really good with their idea, but haven't figured out how to run a corporation. And really, the ones that I see that are very successful both have a good idea, but also have their head around the corporation and who's going to own it, how's ownership going to work, how are decisions going to be made, and all that that goes with it. So corporate structure and legal agreements are the things that we're going to be talking about. So just in the corporate structure, we're going to be talking about just the various things of, you know, how and where to set up the company, what equity ownership looks like, stock options and things for attracting other team members, financings, a little bit of, this is the cap table area where we talk about how people value businesses through various rounds of financing. On the legal agreements part, this is all the documentation around your, not all of it, but you know, high-level review of some of the key documents that you've got to get right. Employment agreements, not having an employment agreement can be that works can be a disaster. Consulting agreements, same. Reverse vesting agreements, where this is where you issue somebody a lot of stock and they leave right after. You need to find ways to claw that back. There's a lot of ways to do a lot of different things through agreement, and sometimes it's just working with somebody that can sort of talk you through these different things you can do to basically you're wanting to take uncertainty out of the equation, and there's lots of ways to do it. So you've got your internal team documents and then your external documents that you'll deal with when venture capital comes its way.
So at a high level, what beyond what we've already touched on are the ways that you could formalize kind of a business arrangement? I'm going to work backwards on this slide because our strong recommendation, and it would be the recommendation of any lawyer that practices in this area, is that you do this through a corporate vehicle, so a corporation. But that's not the only option, technically. There is what's called a proprietorship. That's really just entering into business kind of self-employed and doing everything on your own for what's required to run a business. Now, as many of you mentioned at the beginning, one of the large downsides of this is that you're personally liable for everything. So if you, as a sole proprietor, enter into a lease for space, you're personally liable for the rent payments, as an example. Partnerships, there's two kinds of partnerships, general and limited. As a kind of high-level legal structure, a partnership is when two or more entities enter into business together, and it's usually more of a longer-term engagement, not just one project. And you might have heard, you know, the concepts of limited liability for limited partner and general partners. You know, there are times when that's appropriate, but it's certainly not typical in our world. And again, a partnership is a structure where, you know, your co-founder could, as two general partners, bind you to any number of obligations. And beyond that, it doesn't present a vehicle for financing that certainly we would recommend. Joint venture in similar form is two or more people entering into business together, but usually a specific project, more of a one-off. It could be, you know, that one app or something that two different entities, that one that might be bringing in a specific expertise and the other that's bringing in the missing but required other set of expertise. So joint ventures are a little bit more common, but just to keep things simple, I would say that start with the assumption that you will incorporate either a British Columbia or a federal Canadian company and allow your advisors to convince you otherwise, because far and away it's going to be the best structure, not only for keeping yourselves sane as you wade through the sometimes confusing world of Canadian corporate law, but also accepting financing and what your investors expect. They're contrary to what some of our American counterparts would say. We feel that both British Columbia, especially British Columbia, but Canada in general, is an incredibly great place to do business, raise money, and have success, not only from a corporate structure, but also a tax structure. And we'll touch on that as well for a plug on why you'd want to incorporate instead of any other vehicle.
Right. And just one thing, I've had people sometimes say, oh, we want to set up an LP. If you are creating a structure where income is being generated and you want to disperse income to the partners, an LP is sometimes the way to go because you don't pay corporate tax. Taxes is taxed at the level of the partners. If you actually want to retain income to build a business and it's not just meant to set up as a flow-through entity, corporations are almost always the way to go. Question?
So for provincial companies,
yes.
I see that you've also got federal. So if I'm selling software here,
yeah.
I can understand why you're provincial, but what happens if I want to sell software out in like Toronto or Ottawa? Yeah. Do I have to set up federal?
No. So the good question. This is the question about incorporating locally or incorporating federally. So within Canada, and you don't need to operate or incorporate a Canadian company to do business in Canada. But if you set up a BC company, which is what I generally recommend, I think it's the best corporate law in Canada. If you set up a BC company and you want to do business in a different place, you just extra provincially register your company in that jurisdiction. And that is not creating an additional step versus doing a federal company. If you incorporate a federal company, you still need to extra provincially register in each jurisdiction where you operate. So if you incorporated federally and you operate here, you would register in BC as well. So that's essentially it.
So for each province?
Each province where you conduct, if you wish to conduct business in a province, and it's not just a matter of having stuff on your shelves. If you employ people, if you have a place of business, if you have a number in a phone book, there's a bunch of different tests, but if you have a physical presence in a province of Canada, you're required to register there. Yes?
Just based on that, when we incorporated our business, we chose the federal route.
Okay.
Just based on the name qualification, where BC, you have to have a certain format to the name, and federally, we were able to call ourselves Wallet Card Inc., where in BC, you wouldn't be able to do that.
Yeah, there is, at BC, there's a thing, when you incorporate, they need a descriptor name. And, it's funny, it seems to sometimes depend on who's reviewing the names at the registry that day, because we've squeezed a few through sometimes, but generally, they want a descriptor name, and it could be Investments Limited or just something that clarifies a little bit about what the business is. So, that is one thing with provincial. And if the name, one of the things as well is, what your corporate name is doesn't have to be what you necessarily call yourself all the time. But if you want your full corporate name to be without a descriptor, federal is generally the way to go. Next slide. All right, so we talked a little bit about, this is the box in the middle there is a corporation. This is our separate entity. It employs people, it has officers, it has directors. The circles above S are the shareholders. You sometimes see an advisory panel that advises the board or some industry group. You see that more for startups. Once companies get bigger, that often disappears. We've got a holdco in front of a shareholder. One thing and shareholders normally, your shareholders will advise you how they want to hold their shares, whether they want to hold them personally or through a holdco. If you are running your startup, one of the things to watch out for is generally it's best to hold your shares personally. The reason being, most entrepreneurs want to take advantage of what's called the lifetime capital gains exemption, which is you can, the first $750,000 you realize on the sale of shares of a qualifying Canadian company, which is something owned by Canadians and you've owned your shares for 2 years, you get a capital gains exemption for the first $750,000, but that's only available to individuals. So if you hold your, we often deal with these situations where people are on an exit and they're like, oh great, I'm going to sell my shares. And you know, somebody will tell them, you know, oh, their accountant typically, oh, you're holding them through a hold co. You've just blown out your $750,000 capital gains exemption, and it's you know, you'll still have it, but you've used a good you've lost a chance to use it, and you want to make sure you use it. So that's, you know, often the people that do hold co's have already used their lifetime capital gains exemption, and if you haven't, you know, think about it, because you maybe think, oh, I'm being clever by doing this, but you may have cost yourself a chance to use that. Question in the back.
Hi. Is that capital gains exception one-time use?
One time. Well, it's $750,000 is the lifetime amount. It can be broken up into smaller bits.
Over.
I think
lifetime.
I used $1,500 of mine last year, and okay. I'm hoping to use the rest some other time. So.
Got it. Thank you.
No problem. So that's just one point on that. So the structure, we've got a corporation. There's John will be talking about the directors and the officers. I'll talk a little bit about the employees and the shareholders. Okay, starting on the shareholders. So anybody can be a shareholder. Directors and officers are people. You sometimes get told, you know, I'll get told by a client, oh, this corporation will be the director. It doesn't work that way. Those have to be people. Shareholders can be an individual, a company, a partnership. You take your shareholders as you find them. You can't control, people can hold it how they want. You choose if you want to issue to them, but they'll normally tell you what entity is going to be the shareholder. You can issue as many, you know, you can have as many shareholders as you want. I would say be careful about issuing to as many as you want, just in the sense that as things get moving, and assuming you have a successful company, you want to have a good handle on your shareholder base. And if it's this broad, divergent group of people that have varying interests, and you don't know them, and you can't pull them along to transactions, some of the ones will require shareholder approval. You know, yes, you can issue to as many as you want, but be careful with it. Another important point. Once you cross 50 shareholders, exclusive of employees and former employees, you're no longer a private issuer, and this doesn't make you a public company. It's an often confused point. You're not a public company at that point, but you are no longer a private issuer, and the consequence of that is when you start doing issuances in the future after that point, you need to start filing reports with the securities commissions of all your trades. And that doesn't, you know, in and of itself doesn't sound necessarily like a bad thing, but, and, you know, I guess it's not necessarily, but what happens is, and not all the time, but the securities commission looks at those reports and they sometimes will say, oh, you know, you've issued to a lot of companies. Can you know, we want to come by and look at your share issuances, make sure you've complied with everything. And you know, for those with good paperwork, it's okay, but they'll often go right back to incorporation and ask a bunch of questions. And even if you've got absolutely nothing to worry about, it's going to be a major distraction in terms of time and money. So, if you're going to be a good growing company, you're going to get there eventually, but it's kind of a nice thing to have down the road where you're sort of subject to the, opening the kimono treatment or whatever, you know, however you want to describe it. But you've lost your ability to do these things in private because everything is going to be filed publicly from that point forward.
So just to add a couple things there, and this will be comments that lay the groundwork for slides that we get into is, you know, well, how sensitive are you to who are the people that own your shares? So if we use our holdco example, well, if right now your friend owns their holding company that owns shares in your company, what if they sell the shares in their holdco to somebody else? Now maybe we restrict them through a shareholders agreement or otherwise, but how sensitive are you to the composition of your shareholder base? Second point is, think of the logistical problems with having, you know, yes, 50 is a magic number, but if you were to say, I need $250,000, so I'll ask, 25 people for, each one of them gives me their you know, $10,000. Now you have to go find all 25 people to sign something every year, or else you have to have financial statements reviewed by an accountant, for example. Let's say that a company wants to, or a buyer wants to buy your company, and they want to do a purchase of all the shares. Well, absent things like, you know, drag along provisions, which we'll get into, and shareholders agreements and things like that, can we find all of these people, and are they going to cause us a headache when we go to sell to a potential buyer? So even at the outset, even when many of you are sitting there holding your idea that could be a company, that could be a success, that could be sold, have these things in the back of your head. They're great to consider even at the beginning.
Yeah, that's a good point. You hear about these exits where somebody bought all the shares of the company, right? How do they do that? There's a couple ways, but you know, the number one way is a share purchase agreement with every shareholder, where they buy shares from every single shareholder. And if that's going to be a lot of people that you don't know, that's going to all of a sudden not be an option anymore. And you're going to have to look at other ways to essentially secure the delivery of all those shares to people. And there's ways to do it, but the more people you have as shareholders, you know, certain options are no longer there. And there's always a way to do it, but the degree of cost and complication and uncertainty goes up the more people you have that you've lost connection with. So yes, you know, great raising money, but think about it and try to keep a good handle on your shareholder base. So as we said, shareholders, question.
Just maybe two quick questions. Mm-hmm. So certainly crowdfunding wasn't around when the 50 rule was made up years ago. And so that must have an impact on the regulators. And maybe you could also share, when you do go over 50 shareholders, what the fees are with the BCSE.
Sure. You know, we get asked a lot about crowdfunding these days, and we'll see how it goes. What I've seen so far, it's not that great for issuers. Normally, what you want as an issuer, typically, is to collect a couple big checks from a few people. You know, it's two or three purchase agreements, it's two or three people you're dealing with, it's a piece of cake getting it done like that. We're dealing with one company, and I think there was 180 subscribers. It was 180 purchase agreements that all had to be checked. It was 180, you know, share certs that were issued. It was 180 of this and that, and they were putting in little bits of money. And I don't know what the cost was of it, but it's expensive from a legal perspective, and you're also using one of these funding portholes that's also going to charge a commission on you. And we figured the effective cost of funding may have been sort of 15 to 20% of what they were raising, and maybe more. It's good to have lots and lots of avenues open to people, but I'd be surprised if that ends up being a successful one. The other thing, they've capped it, you can raise like 250 grand on it. So that's, you know, not that, yeah, that's a lot of money in my bank account, but it's, you know, for companies that are really trying to raise money for an idea, it's a lot easier if you can collect a couple, you know, find a couple good private equity type people that can write bigger checks. And then when you're doing your annual resolutions, you're not chasing 180 signatures to waive the audit requirement for this year, because you're never going to get them in. And then in terms of the filing fees for the reports of exempt distribution, I think it's around maybe $150. Though they're not huge, but it's process. You're normally hiring somebody to do it. Unless you do it yourself, it's a pain. Question just behind you.
In terms of crowdsourcing, can a company act as a holdco, as an intermediary between you and the potential crowd funders, so that you're only signing one person's agreement with a holdco, and then they are actually, you know, spreading, divesting that ownership out to crowdfunders.
I'm not aware of anyone having done that. I'm not sure if the exemption works that way offhand. If I thought the exemption was sort of direct and you couldn't bundle it, but I'm not sure if you can get away with it, that would be a good idea, because for most of the securities exemptions, you can't do that. Like the accredited investor one, you can't, you know, aggregate an accredited investor with lots of individuals, and that's sort of one of the principles of securities law. But if you can, the fewer investors you're dealing with, the better. And if that is a way, that would be the way to, you know, a good way to do it for sure. I don't know. Do you know if you can do it through a...
I don't know, but I would certainly look to what surrounds that, and in other areas you can't, you know, if you're not allowed to do something directly, then the law will usually say, you know, you can't do it indirectly, creating a vehicle solely for the purpose of circumventing, you know, a rule, right? Also, think of the practical difficulties with how that entity carries itself as a shareholder of your business dealing with other shareholders, right? So say say you've raised money from 250 people for $1,000 each. And how does that lumbering beast organize itself to make a decision when it is dealing with the other 20 shareholders in your...
Are we going to vote for or against this? Yeah. We'll have to call our own shareholder meeting.
Yeah.
Another question?
I was wondering, what are the rules for foreign nationals, foreign shareholders in local corporations?
There's no restriction at law in terms of where the shareholders are from. What I would say, though, is if you I think once you have foreign control of a company, it's no longer what's called a Canadian-controlled private company. And the stuff I talked about, like a lifetime capital gains exemption and certain other tax treatment, is dependent on being a Canadian-controlled private company. So, yes, you can do it. But your tax rules will change, and it'll affect some of the shareholders' tax planning. So you just have to be conscious of that.
Yeah, and just thinking of what qualifications you'd have to be an investor. A lot of times we have somebody from, I think last year we had a Saudi investor, and they had to be allowed to make that investment under Saudi securities laws, of which I know absolutely nothing. And then they also have to be allowed to make that investment under our laws, and the question was, why should I have to be allowed? I'm over in Saudi Arabia. Why should I have to comply with Canadian securities laws? And so there's a two part. So if you're from a country where, you know, the securities laws are relatively unknown to us here in Vancouver, that's something to consider as well.
How we deal with that practically normally is, for the foreign investor, we get a rep from them that they're complying with the laws of their jurisdiction, and they'll indemnify us if they don't. So it's not, you know, perfect, but that's how we would typically insulate ourselves. And then, BC requires that BC law apply to all issuances of securities of BC companies.
It seems that TSXV or over-the-counters are very popular among startups. Can you comment on that, going public too early?
My background is public company stuff, and we were doing a lot more, both IPOs and RTOs, where you basically, there's a public company shell and you vend a business into it. A lot of that was going on, you know, really up until 2013 or maybe, but the last couple of years, from what I've seen, it's just slowed down a bit. I think the thing, people are getting really poor valuations in the public markets, and it seems it's more popular to, you know, the exit is not going public as much anymore. It's getting bought up while you're a private company by somebody in the US when our dollar is, you know, 30% on sale. So I think people, from what I see anyway, they're avoiding the public markets to try to stay private and get a better valuation. It's what I'm seeing. On just in terms of dealing with the slides, so this is about shareholders. The point of this is that you can carve up your shares in a variety of different ways. Common shares, preferred shares. You can give people preferences, and you know, if we do a share sale, the preferred shareholders get their issue price back first, and then the remainder of the proceeds is split up by everybody equally, and things like that. Voting rights, non-voting rights. One thing I'll say on this: non-voting shares still are something that have to be dealt with on transactions. I've got some clients that they think, we've got all these people that they're all in a non-voting class. Don't worry about it. And for any significant corporate transaction, you give people votes. Corporate law requires you to give people votes on a class-by-class basis. And what you've done is you basically put all these people that are being disenfranchised in the same class, and you need a separate approval vote of that class. So, you know, you're almost stacking the potential dissenters in the non-voting classes. So, I would, you know, just be conscious of that. What I normally do, if it's true non-voting shares and really they're not supposed to have any rights, You want to couple your non-voting shares with a voting trust or a shareholder agreement or some other thing that can, you know, where they sign up in advance that you can force them into an amalgamation transaction or a sale of substantially all the assets, because if you aggregate them in their class by themselves, you're going to have to go to that class and get permission. So that is probably the, you know, my major takeaway on this slide, other than just saying that there's a variety of things you can do. And if you, it, in corporate law, we can accomplish a lot of different, you know, cutting and crafting and whatnot. So there's no issue there. It's you know, you get advice about what you want to do, but be careful about aggregating dissenting people into their own share class.
Yeah, one of the follow-on comments on that is that you know, we in Canada were impacted by a lot about what happens south of the border, and in Silicon Valley is a big one. And there's a progression of what is, and this is a term you've probably already heard and will hear many times, what's market when you're talking about what rights apply to different shares. And so that's really one where I would, you know, it's strongly recommended that if you're ever being presented with, well, this is the way it always is, says, you know, the person that comment would benefit, seek advice, because there's a progression of what is within a reasonable band of rights that are attached to shares, and that's not always one thing. And some of these are very complex issues, as you're probably seeing with even just our brief summary.
Yeah, a market is a word that people throw around to serve their needs. So it's don't just accept it at face value, and there's a broad spectrum of what's market on some points. So just that's certainly good advice. On this next slide, so shareholders, exclusive right to elect directors. Often they're granted preemptive rights on issuances on startups. If you can get away without doing it, try to get away without doing it. Some people will ask for it. Preemptive rights is basically once you've subscribed, anytime we issue new stock to anybody else in the future, you have the right to maintain your, you know, you get a chance to subscribe as well. So, you know, you're a 10% shareholder, you always get a chance to maintain your pro rata 10% interest every time they go to the well for future financings. They're a real pain to deal with. You know, you may have this great new investor come in and say, okay, you know, here's my check for $1 million, and then, okay, well, that's great. Table it for a second. We've got to go back into all these shareholders and ask them if they want to subscribe for a part of that as well, and it slows things down, and it's, you know, you see them a lot, but don't give it away. It's, you're really, you know, you're creating a bit of a headache for yourself. Shareholders' agreements are very, very important and very, very interesting beasts. They're, you know, it depends which shoe the foot is on. I typically act, you know, as company counsel, we typically act for the founder and the business. And there's a lot you can do in a shareholders agreement from the capacity of, you know, being the heavyweight to really make things go tickety-boo in the future in terms of controlling how directors are appointed, controlling what information is shared or not shared, who gets vetoes of certain decisions, that sort of thing. The other perspective, I mean, we often act for minority shareholders that are putting a significant investment into something. And it's, I mean, two very different perspectives. They're hotly negotiated, and they're things that you should really get advice on, because you can really tie up your company in a way you don't want if you're negotiating with somebody that knows more about these than you do. Everything in there is, you know, there's some, you know, relatively standard things, but everything's negotiable, and certainly veto rights, information rights, how directors are elected, restrictive covenants, all up for debate. So make sure that if I owned a business and I was going to bring in a bunch of shareholders, and I said to myself, you're in, you know, if things go great, you're going to get a return on your investment, but I'm driving the bus and it's going to go my way, you need to have a shareholders agreement or else they're going to be blocking things. So just think about that in advance, and you know, if that's part of the deal from your perspective, make sure you put that on the table and get advice around putting the structure together.
Even if they're less than 50% total,
there's dissent rights. There's say you want to, for example, so if the question is, what if they're less than 15%? So say I get a great sale on the business, or a great offer on the business, and they don't want to sell. You know, somebody want, most buyers don't want to buy 85% of a company, they want to buy 100% of the company. So it's a great exit. This guy, he doesn't understand it's a great exit. If he doesn't sell, I can't sell. How are we going to deal with it? So shareholders' agreement, we put in a drag-along right. If, you know, 50%, 60%, whatever, are in favor of a transaction, they can drag the minority and force them to sell. And that easy. And you, deals are completed by using drag-along rights all the time. And if you don't have it, there's other ways to do it. You can, you know, you can do an amalgamation and different things, but then you're giving them dissent rights. And then they can go to court and say it's unfair and different things. So it's, if you're the majority, you want to drive the bus, make sure you put one of these together so you can set out the rights that you're comfortable with going forward.
Okay, so we'll get into the different roles that somebody can have in a company, and there's very specific layers that a company has in its governance model. And so we'll start at the what's called the policy setters, or what we've called it, the directors. So, which is different than the officers of a company. If you were to say, "Oh, I'm the CFO director," those are two separate things, right? So the directors are at the high level and are not only in charge of the strategic, the strategy of the company, but also are their relationship with their company is enshrined in both the common law and statute, which is to say that they have fiduciary duties to the company, duties to act in the best interest of the company. So directors are elected by the shareholders. As an aside here, it's commonplace that if a director leaves, usually between the meeting each year, that the directors themselves can fill the vacancy, and you often can see that, and that's relatively common in our jurisdiction. Also, separate from somebody leaving, usually what you find is the directors can add up to, you know, sometimes a third or a quarter of the total size of the board. So, you know, three directors. Once you get to three directors, then you can add another director, for example. Those are relatively common. Right, you know, obviously you need at least one director. There's no residency requirement in BC. For your federal company, at least 25% of the directors have to be resident Canadians. And so that would be kind of the high level difference. As far as other qualifications, really, it doesn't have to be, it's kind of, you know, the same qualifications for dating your teenage daughter. You can't be criminal, bankrupt, and you have to be under 18, so.
Over 18.
Yeah. Over 18. Yeah.
For them, yeah. I don't know if that's.
Yeah. So no. There's no ceiling on the number of directors, but there's a practical limit, right? Because, you know, if you have, you know, six founders, and you kind of fall roughly into two different worldviews, then every director's meeting could end in stalemate. And we see this a lot. We see people saying, you know, the affairs of the company are grinding to a halt because every time we decide to either do X or Y, you know, the two of us say this and the other two of us say this. And so, you know, sometimes these issues aren't that complicated. An even number means that you could have a stalemate. And so think about that when you are, you know, when you're formulating your board. It doesn't flow naturally that because there's the four of us that are starting this company, all four of us should be directors, really put some thought into, you know, who's going to manage the affairs of the company day to day. You know, if the fourth of your founders is only dedicating 20% of their time, they also have another venture that takes up 80% of their time, then should they be a director? Are they fully engaged in the venture? And oftentimes what you see is that people are very excited to start their company, and they're a little bit more willing to give everybody else that's in for the ride more than maybe they should. And a year or two goes by, and they're regretting that, you know, that sixth person, you know, she or he was really the wrong decision because of this or that reason, or maybe there's sensitivities with that person's engaged in a competing business or things like that. So the directors manage the affairs of the company, and practically speaking, and especially once you're a bit more mature of a company, you'll find that what directors can do is restrained in certain ways by both the rights of the company's rights in their constating documents and also the company's rights in contracts that they've entered into. So a great example would be, and we'll see this in our cap table slides later, let's say that you are lucky enough to raise $1.5 million from, you know, an A-round VC firm. One of the very, you know, market terms for that VC is going to be installing a person on your board. They are going to oftentimes put in the shareholders agreement that if you do any of these things, you know, maybe it's things like borrowing money over X dollars, maybe it's things like increasing management salaries over X percentage, then that particular board member has to say yes or else you can't do it. So you'll see that whereas, you know, I've kind of laid the foundation where the directors are in charge of the high level, you know, vision of the company and make all of the big decisions, as you go, life gets more complicated, as it always does. But none of that takes away from the fact that the directors always have a duty to act fairly and diligently in the shareholders' best interests, and the, you know, the classic scene, you know, and it's, we've seen it recently with a certain national railroad company, is, you know, the directors come up at the AGM and everything short of, you know, tomatoes is thrown at them. And so oftentimes the shareholders will be keenly aware of the decisions that the directors are making, and there's oftentimes disagreements about whether they're truly acting in the best interest of the company. And so as founders, and yeah.
As far as founders are concerned, if you have two founders, one is American, one is Canadian, does that complicate the structure or the formation of that business or the shareholders' agreements and creation of that business? And also, does establishing the company as a U.S. company have any advantages versus establishing it as a Canadian company with a, you know, when I say a U.S. and a Canadian, a U.S. citizen and a Canadian citizen starting that business or founding that corporation?
Yeah, no, it's great questions. If we just take a step back to your two founders, you know, generally speaking, there's not issues at the company level. You know, even if we're at our federal company, we still have 25% resident Canadian directors. We know that from, you know, our previous slides that anybody can be, even our, you know, Saudi investor in my last example, can be a shareholder in your company. I would say that the response to the question is more one of practicality. You know, if you're here and your co-founder is in New York, what practical challenges does that present to your venture? But no, at a very basic level, that certainly wouldn't prevent you from doing anything. Now, I can certainly get into ways that person who isn't a Canadian, you know, might not be able to take advantage of, you know, our tax system and things like that. Well, that's for them to concern themselves about. As far as your question on incorporating internationally, that's something that we touch on, but obviously happy to address it now. Of course, you'll hear things like, and, you know, if you watch Silicon Valley, which is an incredible show, people throw around buzzwords, Delaware company this and things like that. And, you know, if you were to pull out Amazon's org chart, you would see that Amazon probably has companies in various jurisdictions that have really nice beaches. And so, yes, there are reasons sometimes to incorporate internationally. I would say that if you're sitting in this room, I would say it's likely that the benefits to incorporating here outweigh those benefits. If you tell me that you've got someone from the Valley that wants to write you a check for $5 million and they're more comfortable with a Delaware company, then incorporate in Delaware. Given some of the positive reasons why you'd incorporate here, which we'll get into later, you'd need a compelling argument to not have your intellectual property here. You need a compelling argument to not take advantage of our relatively business-friendly tax and corporate structure here. But there are reasons why, for sure. Yeah. So just to tie off the slide, most of you sitting in this room are kind of the founder and therefore would be a director of your company. You might be the only director. Where can you have potential personal liability if you breach your fiduciary duties? So if you do things that aren't in the best interest of your company, egregious example, fraud, something like that. And there is personal liability at law for unpaid wages to your employees, and in some cases for taxes as well. So hopefully nobody ever has to have that conversation with their lawyer, but it is important to address the another one of the key powers that the directors have are to appoint the officers. So
yeah, it's with that one, if somebody asks you to, if you want to be a director of the company, pause before you answer that question, because there is some good that goes with it, but there's liability, and I've been asked that before, and you just sort of, you've got to be aware of the liability, and there's ways to, you can get D&O insurance and that sort of thing, but I would pause rather than just saying yes, because you've got to think through those liabilities that you're being exposed to.
Yeah, so the next level, and oftentimes it's the exact same people, although there is technically a difference, is the officers of the company, the people that are the instructors, and maybe a better word would be kind of the captain of the team. Because oftentimes when, sitting on your side of the room, you might be the only person in your company. So there's that box we had at the beginning, it's only you. And you have three hats. You've got your director's hat, you wear that sometimes. You've got your officer's hat, and you wear that sometimes. You've got your employee hat, and you wear that sometimes. And so the officers are really kind of the captains of the team. They're the ones that are implementing the strategy that's been set forth. At a practical level, you can have as many as you want. You can have any titles. People say, I want to be the CEO, and my co-founder, who's 50% of the company and is the same importance and gets all the same rights as me, they want to be the president. Is there any difference? No, there's no difference. If you were to take some of the companies that have a bit more of a unique culture, you'd find all sorts of interesting titles like chief ideas officer and things like that. So there is no wrong answer. You can set whatever title you'd like. There are obviously titles that are important. Chief financial officer, things like that. Chief technology officer. Those are, obviously important titles to bestow on people that fill those roles.
I think generally if you think, officers at law are typically have been granted a policy-making function within a business, either generally or within a certain unit. So Royal Bank may have, 3,000 vice presidents. They're not vice presidents in the corporate law sense. That's more of a branding thing. The vice president in the corporate law sense is you've got a policy-making function at a company. And just to maybe bring things together a little bit, the way you look at the chain is shareholders hold directors accountable and directors hold officers accountable. So that's how it works. Shareholders are the ultimate decision makers. If they don't like it, they hire new directors. If the directors don't like the way that the officers are performing, they hire new officers. But that's how accountability runs in a company.
Yeah, so the final layer would be employees, not only employees, but consultants, and we'll talk about both. These are your boots on the ground. These are your employees. I think most of us, and I certainly have and am, have been employees of some company at some point in our lives, so this is the one where we probably understand the most, but I'll let Steve get into it a bit more.
Sure. So employees... I think I won't really get into what an employee is because I think we probably all have a basic understanding about that. But I will make the point that it's worth documenting what the terms of employment are. recent case in point is one of my clients calling me and saying, oh, this guy just left. He's gone to a competitor. He's calling all my clients and trying to take them. He's poaching employees. And, you know, I need to stop him. And I say, well, what does his employment agreement say about this? And he doesn't have an employment agreement. Well, there's not really anything you can do about it. So an employment agreement allows you to set the terms and put parameters around what somebody can do while they're there and what somebody can do after they leave. So it's, you know, if you don't care about particularly what they do after they're gone, then fine. But if you do care about any of these things, you want it set out in an employment agreement. So confidentiality, ownership around IP. If you don't have clear terms, people may say, oh, you know, law really does grant a lot of IP interests to the individual that came up with it. So unless you specifically contract out of that, some of that stuff, moral rights in relation to use of trademarks, stuff that may have been done, you know, with company property but outside of business hours, does that belong to you or does that belong to them? I know the owner always thinks, well, that should have belonged to me, but the answer is less clear. So in your employment agreement, you want to deal with a lot of things, but confidentiality, ownership issues around IP, non-competition, potentially going to competitors, non-solicitation of employees and customers. If you're silent on all this stuff, or you don't have an agreement documenting it, you're fighting an uphill battle trying to get anybody to stop any of that stuff. So at your peril, engage people without agreements. Question.
Can you revise an employee agreement while they are an employee? And is there any terms, conditions around termination for them not agreeing to the updates to that employment agreement if it's possible?
So the first question, so we often see people enter into new agreements with employees when they become aware of these things. That is possible. The issue is, and it's, you know, you've got to do it right. You have to offer fresh consideration. One of the principles of any contract is that you can't just change a term to somebody else's detriment without offering them something back because they say there's no consideration. So there has to be consideration on both sides. And it can't just be, well, if you don't sign it, we're going to fire you. So what we normally would do in situations like this, if you need to put new terms in, you offer some form of fresh consideration, and that could be some bonus, some days off with pay, some other term that may be valuable to them. And it can't just be trivial. It's got to be, you know, of some, you know, reasonable significance. So yes, you can do it, but you should do it in a very calculated way with advice to ensure it's enforceable. And that's the whole thing with employment law is getting enforceability, and it's all about fresh consideration when it's in this context. So we often see this on change of control transactions where a business, you know, an acquirer is coming in and they'll look at, you know, either there is no employment agreements or they're terrible. And one of the conditions of closing will be fresh employment agreements with all of these people, and part of the proceeds of the transaction sometimes will be the consideration payable to these people to enter into fresh employment agreements and, you know, signing bonuses or that sort of thing. But it's good to get cleaned up, but you can't just unilaterally impose new terms.
And that's only effective from the date they sign the new terms? It doesn't backtrack?
If you signed a non-solicitation thing, it would be going forward, but it would only be relevant going forward. I guess, you know,
say if it's IP.
Yeah.
Hire someone.
I see. Yeah.
And then,
you know, they've developed something during that month, and then you realize, oh, I need to change the employment agreement.
Yeah.
And so, can you ask them to go and backdate that? So the IP that they developed in that first month, they can't
use. You know, that is a better question for an IP lawyer, which I am not, but what I suspect is you would want to belt and suspenders that with an IP assignment agreement as well, if you wanted certainty. It would probably be fairly fact-specific, and you'd go through that with an IP lawyer, but yeah, and that's a great point. The IP can be created absent an agreement, and you will want to deal with that. And it could be the employment agreement, it could be an IP assignment agreement. Good question.
We had that last year, and we had to have 15 people sign confirmatory IP assignments that said all these things in the past are the company's. But it's also to the person's benefit, because in a couple cases they said, well, the way that you've worded this assignment would have covered this other, great app that I'm developing. So can we say that, and it's not related to the company, can we say that that's not included? So what we did is to say, okay, for greater certainty, this other thing that we referenced specifically isn't included in the assignment. So there's actually reasons on both sides why, and again, getting certainty and putting things on paper, why you'd want that.
All right. Consultants, let's check for the time here. We're starting to bog down a little bit in terms of getting through things, so I'll be quick on this. Consultants is something be careful with. I've dealt with a couple clients that, they don't have any employees. All they have is consultants. All their consultants work for them full time. You were kind of creating an artificial construct here. Law recognizes employment when you're full-time, when you're working there, exclusivity, you're using the company stuff, not your own tools. A true consultant is somebody there, they have their own equipment, they're not exclusive to one place. They're required at law to deduct EI and all those other things, and it's not the company. There is risk to getting it wrong if all you do is hire consultants. The CR and they are not remitting like they should be remitting, and you're not remitting because they've told you they're a consultant. If it doesn't get paid, the CRA is going to come back to the company for that. So think about it that way. And quite frankly, if the true relationship is employment and there's a dispute, the employee is going to say, I was really an employee, and the human rights code or employment standards and all this apply to me. So often these things are done at the request of the consultant, but it's the company that's taking on risk. So be careful with it. And certainly, if you're going to go down this road, in any consulting agreement, make sure that they will indemnify you if they're classified by the CRA as an employee, because you do not want to be on the hook for all the remittances that they haven't made over time. So think about that. And so just on this one, same issues in terms of restrictive covenants for consultants as well. You want the confidentiality, non-solicit. Non-competition may be a bit more of a stretch, but certainly assignment of IP as well. And CRA redesignation, be careful with it. They look at the reality of the relationship, and if they're working with you and they're not providing services to a lot of different people, they'll say, that's an employee, why didn't you remit? Deducting taxes at source and all that other stuff.
So, one of the inevitable questions is how do you compensate your people, however we have designated them or you've designated them. And the most common question is, I'm a startup, I have this government grant, I have this money from my friends and family, that gives me 6 months of runway at best. There's no chance I can pay all these people market salaries. Of course you can't. So compensation for a startup is really not only cash, obviously, in some cases, but through equity, through giving people an equity interest that, through in part their sweat, will be worth a lot one day in theory. And you saw an outcry with the new Liberal government when they even hinted at changing the rules surrounding stock options and things that tech companies legitimately use to comp their people because of how valuable it is. So what oftentimes we see is is, you know, your more important people being compensated through a mixture of shares and options. Now, what does that mean with shares? Well, I'll get into it later, but it means that when the company is first started and the company's brand new, it's not worth anything, that person is getting shares that, just like the company is of no value, the shares are basically of no value. They're worth, you know, a thousandth of a cent. On the understanding that they are going to be engaged in the venture and they're going to contribute to the success. Same thing with options. You might have grant one of your people a very large grant of options, and those options have a strike price, so the price that you would pay to exercise the option to receive a share, which is very low, on the understanding, the same understanding. So how do you, and why do we do this? Well, we do this because if that same person makes that contribution, we can't give them free shares in 2 years after we've raised money because we know that the fair market value of that share is much higher. And CRA will say, well, no, you can't, you know, issue shares at a thousandth of a cent to X because you just raised money at 50 cents a share, and so that gain benefit could be classified as employment income, as an example. Now, how do we get around this? Because the person or persons haven't actually done the thing that we based our grant of options or issuance of shares on. Well, the way we do that is, and which we'll touch on later, is through vesting. And so that says, okay, I'm going to issue you 1 million shares now, but it takes 4 years to get them all, and they're gonna vest over 48 months equally. And so you can see the relationship between the compensation and what that individual is doing to earn it. Sometimes it's not time. Sometimes, you know, the five of you are working on an app and getting it to beta is really all that matters. And you say, okay, well, I'm going to issue you 1 million shares, and you get half of them when the app hits, you know, the Apple Store, for example. There's lots of different ways to do it. And again, this is a great area where, you know, you're going to lean on your professional advisors. There's a lot of different ways that you can get somebody compensated in a manner where they're happy with it. And there's also non-dilutive funding sources, government funding sources to cover salaries in certain cases. And so just, you know, ear to the ground and also rely on your advisors for what is, you know, to use a terrible word again, market.
Going to take a brief 5-minute break?
Yeah, I think just like 5 minutes.
Yeah, good. Okay.
Yeah, sounds good.
All right, we're going to jump back into it here, and some of these questions have been just kind of really on point and addressing things that we bring up later, so we might go through certain concepts that have kind of been discussed already. But again, at all points, please interject with questions if you have them. So in our original structure, we saw that there was this other box to the right, an advisory board. And what does that mean? Well, an advisory board is really you know, kind of an arm's length group of advisors, often industry experts, but they're not directors, that have relevant industry experience in your field that you contract with to provide guidance, to provide you with guidance at a very limited basis, and they have a very limited role to play, and they accept no liability. And oftentimes they advise exclusively the board on kind of high-level strategy and things like that. A lot of times companies enjoy having advisors because it lends an air of prestige if you can get famous people or successful tech entrepreneurs onto your advisory panel. And you incentivize them with usually options. And you know, and just the only thing I'll leave at this point is oftentimes we see companies that manage to engage industry leaders, but these are extremely busy people, so don't expect there to be a ton of engagement with your advisors that are already maxed out. And this is really, if you can get it, great, but oftentimes an advisory board isn't something that you should expect will come together and come together well. So the question is, are advisors liable? And in almost no case will an advisor accept any liability. They're only engaged to the company by virtue of a contract they sign, and in that contract, there's no chance that an advisor would accept any liability. No.
All right, I'm going to be trying to power through things
as much as possible. So on the conflict of interest slide, all I'm going to say really is that, you know, there are rules out there for conflict of interest. If you've got, you know, for related party transactions, or if you've got a benefit of a contract, if it's not disclosed to the board, if you're a director and you haven't disclosed your interest, you can be held accountable for any profits you've made. So there are rules. Be aware of them. Think about conflict of interest. Think about, well, is this, you know, me, you know, is this, am I acting for the company here, or am I acting for me? You know, my CEO agreement, it's a sweetheart agreement. You know, should I be getting advice, and should be the company be getting advice from somebody else in relation to that agreement, because we've got conflicting interests? So be alert to them, and remember there are provisions in the statute that realign things if people, you know, neglect to disclose them prior to transactions. Corporate structuring, I think we touched on this a little bit. I think, you know, BC and Canada have great corporate law, and most of the, you know, the clients we have access that we deal with don't seem to have any issues fundraising here. If somebody's prepared to write you a very big check on the basis that you're incorporated in the US, then that may be a good reason to do it. But absent something like that, Canada's good. We've got good tax credit programs where people can invest and get, you know, invest a dollar and get 30 cents back on their tax return the next year. Things like that, that all that goes out the window if you're in the US. Your ability to realize on the lifetime capital gains exemption is gone as a shareholder if you're in the US. So absent, you know, some unique things, you know, I'd be hesitant to incorporate in the US.
What happens if you're a US citizen investing in a Canadian company? Do you get 30%?
No, the way the tax credit works is when you file your tax return in British Columbia, you get 30% back, and the US shareholder wouldn't pay any taxes here, so they wouldn't get a credit against taxes paid. So it doesn't benefit them that much, but it leaves more tax credits for your BC investors. In terms of BC versus federal, as we said, you know, we typically act for the person that's driving the bus here, and BC law generally allows the majority to do more without minority approval requirements, and clients that want to get things done quickly and effectively, like BC companies, because you're not having to grant dissent rights to people in a variety of circumstances. You don't have to produce the same disclosure documents. You don't have to invite the director of Industry Canada to court for a plan of arrangement application, things like that. So if you're the majority, I think you like BC law better because it allows you to operate more freely and without as many procedural requirements. So on this slide, initial corporate structuring, if you're setting it, I've got one client that, you know, they've got Class A through Class J shares and they're all over the place. It's fine if it's your personal holding company. If you want to create a vehicle that people want to invest in, have a class of commons, have what we call blank check prefs, which is basically a basic set of preferred share rights and the ability for directors to issue, you know, various classes or series on the same basis. So it's quick, easy, and readily financeable. Avoid issuing secured debt. As soon as you've granted somebody a GSA, which a general security interest over all or substantially all of your or all your present, future, after acquired property, no lender is going to want to lend you money until they kick that person out. Being a lender to a corporation, it's all about being in first place from a security interest point of view. Nobody wants to be in second place because you never know if anything's going to be left. So make sure you've saved your first GSA for your big lender. Because nobody, as I said, nobody's going to want to lend if it's already there. Shareholder loans. The issue with this is when you deal with an investor coming if they see these shareholder loans all over the place, they're going to say, "Great, I'm going to pay you money for equity, and you're just going to pay back your shareholder loans." So, you know, they normally, if you've done them, they're going to want them tied up as part of the deal. Whether they're going to they may want them to convert to equity or be paid back on schedule or something like that, but if they're sitting out there, it's something to have to deal with on your next big financing round. And I think those are the big points on that slide.
What's the GSA?
Oh, sorry. So GSA, it's basically granting a security interest over your assets. So it's kind of a lending concept, but in the event of insolvency, it makes the person that has the GSA a secured creditor. And in insolvency, there's a line, they call it a waterfall, but to the extent that there's funds dripping out, the secured creditors get to fill their cup first. And until their cup is full, there's nothing that goes to the unsecured creditors. So if you're going to lend money, any substantial bit, you want to be secured, it puts you in first place. And on a wind-up, you get paid first. And if there's anything left, it goes to everybody else. So I hope that deals with the question.
Yeah, just to tie that one up, it's and there you'd have a perfected security interest would be the highest. So you'd have a registered charge in the personal property registry. The most common one, which many of us have in this crazy city, is mortgage, which is a perfected security interest. So when somebody pulls up your land, they see the mortgage. When somebody pulls up your company, they would see that X has a security interest over you. And that person has the highest standing. But those are all things to save, like Steve said. So founder shares, we've talked about this a little bit going through the last hour. Founder shares are, like Steve mentioned, hopefully just common shares that you have, but they're referred to colloquially as founder shares because they're kind of the initial issuances that the company has. If you were coming to us with how to start your company, I'll try to be uniform because there is somebody in here that I already gave this advice to. And you're looking for around, 6 million shares, common shares, and you're going to break that down how you see fit amongst your founders. If it's just you and there's somebody else but their engagement is fleeting, then maybe you're the only shareholder. If there's three of you and you all agree that, all three of you are going to give equal sweat into this thing and you're all bringing different tools to the job, then maybe you each get 2 million shares. Much like stalemates with the director's decisions, there's going to be stalemates created or majorities created for better or worse as a function of how you break down the equity ownership of your company. And like I mentioned before, they're nominally priced shares. These are, when you think of how Mark Zuckerberg had, millions of shares at a fraction of a penny, and now those shares are worth an incredible sum. They did start at this same concept of founder shares.
Except he has super voting shares.
What's that?
Except he has super voting shares.
Yeah, 100 years ago, he just had simple shares, though. Yeah. But obviously, as you're all gaining kind of a theme here, you will get more complex the more successful you get. So absolutely, it's a good point. So founder shares, who should they be issued to? It's just your senior people. It's not your employees. It's not your outside investors. And it's also, I would recommend against this, and it's something that's I've seen a lot, is it's not that guy that says he can raise $3 million for you. And therefore, because you can't pay him anything, you say, okay, well then I'll give you these shares because you know a lot of people with money, and hopefully you go get that. That brings up a whole other can of worms that we don't have enough time to get into. But let's just keep it with the founders and the senior people. So what are mistakes people make? Not setting up aside enough. Let's use our three founders example. Well, if you each get 100 shares. Then when it comes time to convince your internal accountant to stay with your company and you want to give them shares, you might be giving them 2 shares. Well, there's nothing legally wrong with 2 shares, but it looks really weird. And sometimes aesthetics are important to how we formulate our company. So not setting aside enough founder shares at the time of incorporation, if for nothing other than how it looks, is an important consideration. Not considering the future additions to the management team, not vesting the founder shares. We had an issue a couple years ago where there was 4 founders, and they all, on our advice, had 2 million shares each of founder shares, so 8 million shares. Well, they got in a huge fight about 6 months in, and one of them, as an aside, they said, okay, we'll worry about the shareholders agreement later. Well, they got in a huge fight, and one of them left. Well, now there's this guy with 2 million shares. There's no contractual right that we as the company have to deal with him. And if this company goes to the moon, then he has 2 million shares given to him on the understanding that he would contribute to the success, and he's not going to. So did not turn out well for...
So the reverse vesting is giving the company an option to repurchase the shares at the same nominal value, you know, in stages if he leaves. So, you know, they may vest, you know, monthly or quarterly, but if he leaves after 6 months, you know, maybe 75% get repurchased at the same issue price.
Yeah.
Thank you. Can shares structure of a company be revised if it's like at the beginning of when the company is registered? If you go with a share structure but you want to revise it later on, what are the limitations once it's passed the registration? What can't go back?
In the one issue, in terms of not, you know, the issuing the accountant 2 shares and whatnot, what normally people, I've seen companies, they'll just do a stock split and they'll do 1,000 for 1, and those 100 shares are, you know, split into 1,000 each or something like that. Does that address the question, or is there more to it than that?
Well, no, I meant say if there are 3 directors in a business and you have allocated like 100 shares for each, or 100 shares per for all 3 of them. Can they go back and revise these amount of shares, like these number of shares, or is it just set forever?
No. I would say there's two ways to answer that. So it's not set forever. So for example, in the setting of the 3 directors, can that be changed? Yes, every year the directors are elected by the shareholders. So, you know, if one of those directors is a mistake, then that's dealt with through the passage of time. If through the issuance of their shares, if there's not a contract that says that their shares can be repurchased, so the vesting concept we've touched on, then technically speaking, no, that 100 shares in itself will still exist. Now, it could be subject to the will of a majority of that class of shares. So in Steve's example, if the 100 needed to be split to 1,000 and 2/3 of the class of shares agreed to do it, then that person would now hold 100,000 shares. But what usually happens is their position is eroded as a function of the development of the company, so they accept investment. That founder doesn't invest, so that 100 shares is now less and less of a percentage of the company. That's really how it's dealt with. And again, just to answer the other construction issue, if you had incorporated your company like it was a laundromat and you had class A to J shares, and you know, you were incorporating it like you were going to be distributing profits on an ongoing basis, and you didn't want to do that, then you could still revise the structure of the company to simplify it and kill all those extra classes of shares. There's a lot that you can do, and Steve can correct me if I'm wrong, but I would say that where you hit the blinking red light is if you're going to do something that prejudices somebody, then that's when you really want a lawyer to put a microscope on it.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Thank you. I think you just answered my question, but I just wanted to confirm with it. About classes of shares. So you said we can kill classes of shares. That means that we can add classes of shares if you're like lacking number of sufficient classes.
You can, you know, with votes of shares, you know, some stuff will require shareholder approval, but provided you have the votes of shareholders, there's very little you can't do with a share structure. You can add, you can remove, you can exchange, you know, the A's for the B's, reclassify the B's, all variety of things. But if you have somebody that objects, it gets harder and harder to do stuff. And that's where shareholders' agreements, voting trusts, and all these things factor in, because it's tough to do stuff without people's consent if you don't have these things in place.
Yeah, and again, all of these things we're talking about, you know, you're paying potentially lawyers, potentially looking, receiving tax advice on this. These are expensive propositions sometimes, and my contention would be, why? You know, why are you doing this when you could have started the company with a very simple structure? Okay, so to move to the next slide, preparing a financing plan. So we're getting into more of the money side of raising of starting a business, which is where, you know, as a caveat, I would say, you know, consult the professionals on that. But where it kind of meets the legal side is, you know, determine your roadmap for financing. What do you need, and you know, how often are you going to need that amount? So a lot of times we have startups say, well, you know, to realize on my project, I need this amount of money so that I can hire this amount of people. Or in other cases, it's I need to buy this extremely expensive piece of equipment. And so as long as you have a very clear goals, you're gonna have a compelling case for why an investor should give you money and what you'll do with that money and how that money will be used for growth and ultimately shareholder value. So sources of financing. Non-equity financing, so I've referred to this before, the non-dilutive financing. So this is money that is received that doesn't result in an equity ownership of the company. So you'll receive money often from government, and they won't expect to actually own your company. So you have the value of the money, but you don't have to give up a percentage of your ownership. So IRAP and SRED, these are government programs that I hope you're at least familiar with by name, but I would say that they're roughly speaking government programs where intellectual property is developed in Canada. It's a certain kind of intellectual property, and as a result, there's tax credits and government grants that apply. They can also apply to industry-specific things like the film industry or the environmental industry. Or certain environmental industries. And so a couple times people have said, well, why don't I incorporate in the US? Well, this is a great reason why, because in some cases there's zero eligibility for these government programs, and in some cases very limited eligibility. And also financing sources from quasi-government, like the BCIC, BDC, programs that are available to entrepreneurs. We deal with BDC a lot. They're extremely investor friendly, and these are really valuable programs to take advantage of. So, you know, I would say that if you haven't read up on these, a Google search is a great place to start, and they're very company friendly, and so they'll be happy to help. As far as equity financing is concerned, the most common progression is starts with the founders, bootstrapping, putting your own skin in the game. This is something that oftentimes investors are going to want to see, that you're actually committed to the venture. Friends and family is oftentimes the next source of funding. These are the people that are, you know, actually investing in you, not your idea, because oftentimes they don't understand your idea, but they're nevertheless willing to write you a check. And they're a critical source of funding. You're getting in at probably the highest risk profile that the investment can have, and therefore, as you'll see in our cap table, they're coming in at a relatively low valuation. Follow-on rounds are often seen from angels, and Vancouver and British Columbia and Canada have a pretty prolific angel network. What I would say at the angel and VC stage, you know, investment bankers and underwriters are a little less common in this jurisdiction, is that you're going to get people that have done this before. Certainly it goes without saying. You're also going to get people that can add a certain level of expertise and you know, might be more than just a check. Those are really the kind of how the roadmap looks for getting more and more sophisticated money in the door. I'm not sure if... So if we were to say, if you were to ask us, well, what do you usually see? You know, you can see friends and family giving anywhere from 50 to 150. And again, these numbers are very fluid. This just gives you kind of a sense of some of the numbers that you see. I think that speaks for itself, so I'll continue moving. Okay, so there's one of the slides that we've updated just because of how important it is in this jurisdiction is the VC venture capital programs. This is the 30% tax credit that was mentioned earlier in passing. This is, so in BC, If you are an eligible business corporation or a BCC, then you can receive investment, and a BC resident can get a 30% refundable tax credit for the investment that they're making up to $200,000, so they would get $60,000. This is a refundable credit, so they don't have to apply it against income. This is literally a check from the government. This is an extremely popular program, and to be honest, it often drives the deal. And every year, the tax year for this program is March to March, and every single year, there's a furious rush before the tax credits run out, and it literally drives financings. So, what's that? Do they run out, or? The year is March to March, and so they run out different every year.
Yeah. It was February 29th this year was, frenetic, crazy activity, and they've got certain amounts for each different class of business, and we're not a biotech company, we're this type of company, and everybody trying to shoehorn in, because they'll move credits around, but it's a mad scramble because they're real money, so people really want access to them.
Sorry, can you explain that 30% as an example?
If they invest $1 million, they get a check from government, $300,000.
No, so the limit, like I said, is $200,000. Yeah. So you get the most you can get is $60,000.
So they get it as a credit in their.
They get it as it's a refundable credit. You get a check from the government. Oh, okay. Yeah, so it's an incredibly powerful program, and just to be clear, if I invest in your company and you're eligible and I have $200,000, I get my $60,000. You sell your company for incredible sums of money, I still get my lifetime capital gains exemption. And I've still taken advantage of everything else. Yeah. It's not either or.
There's a couple of rules, and these also drive deals, unfortunately, sometimes as well. If the company's sold within 5 years, you have to repay the tax credit. So you sometimes, at 4.5 years, I think you have...
Yeah,
the shareholders say, no, don't exit yet, because they're... Once you've done the full 5 years, you get to keep it, but it can be repaid in certain circumstances. So, if there's a change of control of the company within 5 years, you can be called upon to repay the tax credit. The $60,000 you got, they'll want it back. Mm-hmm. So you get paid the money in advance, but it can become repayable if there's a change of control within 5 years. So. You sometimes see deals where the company's ready to be sold, but shareholders are pushing.
You just send it back to the BC government.
The BC government, they'll be required to repay it. They'll have to chase you for it, theoretically, I guess, but you will have an obligation to repay that tax credit.
Yeah, so just to put some other information on the table, how can you as a company be eligible? You have to be doing a certain set of qualifying activities. Those are all set out on the website. You have to have $25,000 of investment already in, so that first 25 doesn't count for tax credits. And you founders can't get the tax credits, just to be clear. Now on the repayment side, not only can you lose it for selling the shares, but you can lose it if the company itself goes offside of being eligible. So a great example would be moving all the intellectual property to Barbados or something. And how do you stay qualified? Under 100 employees, at least 75% of your wages are paid in BC, at least 80% of the assets are in BC. There's certain annual reporting requirements, but not to get into those right now. We actually had a deal a while ago where the company was being sold for a 5x return on this round of investment 4.5 years later. And the shareholders held this deal basically hostage until 5 years plus a day, so that they didn't have to repay their tax credits. The one nuance to that is that if for some reason these investors are selling at a loss, there is a certain reduction in repayment obligation. So if you're selling those shares at a loss, then the branch might not make you pay all of it.
There's also a trick. I've seen people where they'll tender their shares for cancellation because the value of the tax credit is worth more than the shares worth, and they'd rather keep the tax credit than transfer the shares and have to repay the tax credit. So there's a little bit of finagling that can be done there as well.
That 30% is not for public companies, if it's public.
It's no, I don't. You don't.
I've never seen that.
It may be. You only typically see it on the private side. Somebody told me that they were eligible for tax credits as a public company. It surprised me. I haven't verified it, but it was another lawyer, so can't trust it.
There's under 100 employees, and there's certain other kind of I'm big, I don't count requirements. So those practically sometimes disqualify public companies.
All right, so it's 8:45, so I'm going to let you guys power through, but you guys get to stick around after to answer more
questions.
Yeah,
okay,
happy to do that.
So we didn't have that break.
Yeah, that was our break.
Thankfully, it's the most exciting part of the talk.
Okay, so securities legislation, I'll try to compress this. We've got a bunch of slides, but there's a couple key concepts here. In securities law, there's a distinction between retail and the exempt market. So retail is mom and pop, people that aren't connected to the business friends and family or whatnot, or they're not wealthy, and that's the proxy for being a sophisticated investor. So if you're going after the retail market, you need to file a prospectus and become a public company. And this isn't a public company seminar, and most people early on don't want to do that because there's a ton of obligations and financial disclosures and whatnot. So assuming you want to stay private, you're relying on exemptions from the prospectus requirements. So the securities law provides a bunch of exemptions, and whenever you see a subscription agreement, there's always going to be detail around demonstrating that you fall within one of the designated exemptions. So friends and family, close business associates, credit investor, a private issue exemption, which is sort of a combination of a few different, the $150,000 exemption, which is it's a corporation now, it's no longer an individual, but buying $150,000 worth of securities. There's the crowdfunding exemption that we talked about, there's an offering memorandum exemption, and then the employee director officer consultant exemption. So, and there's a couple more, but these are the ones you typically see. So if you want to issue shares to somebody and not become a public company and not get in trouble from the Securities Commission, you need to put people into one of these categories. So friends, family, and business associates, it's basically, they list out director, officer, and founder, and if you're the spouse, you're the brother, you're the sister, there's a few designated relationships. If somebody ticks that box, they're eligible to invest in your company on an exempt basis. So that's one of the exemptions. So the close personal friend or close business associate is one that we always see as a flashing yellow light for companies. The Securities Commission view is that these are not to be used very broadly. This is not your Facebook friend. This is not somebody you met at some sort of networking event. These are people that you've known for years. These are people that know where the bathroom is in your house, is one way that people put it. That's what the exemption is meant to be. It's somebody that knows you and can take that knowledge of you over a period of years to determine that they think you're trustworthy and they would be prepared to invest in a business you're involved with. So it's meant to be a very narrow exemption. If you turn it into a broad exemption and somebody complains to the Securities Commission about their investment, you're going to be on their radar and they're going to be opening up your books. So use it very sparingly. And if you're using it, take down detailed notes of, I've known this person for this many years, we've worked on this together, put that in the file. It's meant to be a very narrow exemption rather than a broad one. I think that's essentially the same thing. So, accredited investor. So this is, it's the wealthy individual exemption. It's in securities law, they haven't come up with a proxy for sophistication, and the easiest way to do it and the only objective test is money, I think, from their perspective, rather than making people do IQ tests before they've subscribed. So it's money is the basis on which they've determined is the most objective way to determine sophistication. So the general ones that you see is somebody with $1 million of financial assets before taxes. So that's, and that financial assets excludes real estate. Somebody with an income that exceeds 200 grand or 300 grand if combined with their spouse in the two most recently completed years and expectation going forward, or individuals who have net assets of $5 million, which includes real estate. So those are the typical individuals that subscribe as accredited investors. And the rules now are just having somebody blindly tick a box and saying, well, they tick the box. The Securities Commission, as of last year, said that's not enough. You have to take reasonable steps to verify that. So again, if it's somebody that you sort of can put down a note in the paper, yes, they worked on this company and or you've got some familiarity, fine. But if you're just blindly relying on it or you have reason to believe that they're misrepresenting, it's not going to get you off the hook. So be somewhat careful with that. So private issuer exemption is sort of a combination of a bunch of them. It's your directors, officers, employees, family members, close personal friends, current shareholders, family members, credit investors. So if you, so long as you issue to these people and you have less than 50 shareholders in the aggregate, you will be a private issuer. If you issue to one person that's not on this list, you will lose your private issuer status. Once you've lost it, you can never get it back. So it's not the end of the world losing your private issuer status, as we said, but it doesn't make you a public company, but it means you're going to start filing reports of all your trades with the Securities Commission, which is not inherently a bad thing, but inevitably will lead to questions, and it's, once you get questions, then it's, you're having to drag up the books and demonstrate to them why so-and-so really was a close personal friend, why so-and-so really is a close business associate, and the like. So I would say hang on to your private issuer status as long as possible. And that's some of the restrictions. So loss of private issuer status, I think we talked about this. $150,000 exemption, somebody buying $150,000 in one shot. What you can't do is have 15 people put in 10 grand each, incorporate a company, and use that exemption. It's got to be a company incorporated for other purposes. So just be aware of that. It's not an indirect way of getting around things. Startup crowdfunding exemption, as I said, it's talked about quite a bit these days, but there's a couple things that I think are problematic with it. One, it's, as I said, it's not necessarily always a good thing to have lots and lots of shareholders. It's going to make it very costly to do things in the future. It's very unwieldy. Doing the financing itself takes a lot of time and money because you're dealing with hundreds of subscription agreements, and you have to do it through a portal. You're going to have to pay them fees. So I don't think it's a silver bullet. I think until they raise the amounts and make compliance easier, it's not going to be a super cost-effective way of financing. And we can talk about that after with anybody that wants to ask questions about it. Offering memorandum exemption, don't see it that much these days. It's you come up with a very basic sort of offering document, about 15, 20 pages long. It's got a risk acknowledgement. You have to give people rights of rescission, meaning that they can... there's a cooling off period of a couple days if they change their mind, and you file it with the Securities Commissions. So, and this allows you to issue, I think the NVBC, the minimum amount is $5,000 or something like that, but it's another exemption. They don't have to be accredited investors and they don't have to be friends and family. If they're purchasing under an offering memorandum, though, I would say, again, in most respects, it's not the most cost-effective way to raise financing, and it's always better to find a couple wealthy accredited investors. There's liability on an offering memorandum. If you're giving them disclosure, if there's anything that wasn't true, intentionally or inadvertently, you'd give them, they have a right to sue based on misrepresentation. So, whereas if people are just purchasing on a one-page subscription agreement and you haven't made reps and warranties and haven't given them disclosure, there's not much that they can sue over. So be aware of that. And then just one thing on this slide as I'm powering through. The consultant exemption is not one of the prescribed categories within the private issuer exemption. So if you issue to consultants, you are no longer a private issuer. So be careful with that one. It's not the end of the world no longer being a private issuer, but there are some consequences that you may want to avoid. That's it for me.
Yeah, so appreciate the limited time we have left. So raising money, we've set up our company and now we're going to go out and we're going to get money. What does that look like? Well, there's a series of documents, no surprise, that apply to that as well. The first would be a non-disclosure agreement. So if we're going to go show people why it is that they should give us money, then we want to be protected so that those people don't take our ideas. And so oftentimes we will have them enter into a non-disclosure agreement. It could be mutual or one way, depending on by virtue of the relationship. Maybe they're also disclosing some confidential information to us. Things to keep in mind would be the length of the agreement and also what obligations it imposes on you. Sometimes these things will say, nothing's confidential unless you actually put the word confidential on it. And so all of a sudden now you have to make sure, okay, every email I send or deck or anything like that says confidential on it. Something to consider. A term sheet will set out the basics of the financing that you're doing. So we talked about friends and family, angels. So and angels or VCs or things are going to expect a term sheet. They're going to want to look at one or two pages that says, here's the company, here's what they're asking for, and here's what I'm getting. So you're going to set out what type of security you're offering. Oftentimes it's shares, but it could be convertible debt, things like that. You're setting out a valuation. One of the absolute hardest things to nail down for a startup, a lot of times people in your shoes will say, I have to figure out what my shares are worth. I have no idea. And the answer is, well, your shares are worth what somebody will pay for them. That's a very unsatisfying answer, but it's oftentimes as good as it gets. And not only a valuation, but what is that valuation based on to come up with a price per share? Is that based on just the shares that are outstanding, maybe just the founder shares we talked about, or maybe it also includes some of those options we were talking about, even though those options haven't turned into shares yet? What are you going to do with the proceeds? Getting back to our financing plan, maybe the investors' proceeds are going to be used for that specific piece of equipment. Maybe it's just going to be used for general growth. Those are both financers. And what are the investors getting? Maybe there's a shareholders agreement that's granting them a whole host of rights, the vetoes over everything you do, a board seat, this and that. And so a term sheet will spell that out all in limited detail, but enough that they kind of know what it's about. A subscription agreement is the vehicle through which they're actually going to buy these shares. And so it says, okay, you're going to buy this number of shares or other securities for this price, and here's all these promises we're going to make about these shares in the company. As a startup, oftentimes, you're a simple company. You don't have a lot to disclose because you don't have a lot going on. There's not a lot of skeletons in the closet, and so these can be very simple agreements. But as you progress as a company, sometimes they take on a huge life of their own, and the promises that you'll be forced to make about your company are 20, 30 pages long, and it gives an investor almost everything that they could ever be known about your company.
Can we just take one break? Yeah. I realize it's 9 o'clock now, and some people likely have to go. We've got probably about 10 more minutes to do, so for anybody that has to go, you've got places to go, feel free to leave, and for those that are able to stay, we'll continue on. Hopefully 10 more minutes, and then we'll be around to deal with any questions, if that's okay. So everybody can stay. Great.
Yeah. Buying shares is one thing. Another, you've probably heard this, is convertible debt. It is debt, so there's a maturity date and a repayment requirement, but it can be converted into equity, usually upon a future financing. But this has a lot of the hallmarks of debt, like Steve mentioned, a security agreement. Oftentimes, if you've convinced, five or six people, angels, to invest, you have to have what's called an interlender agreement, where they all agree that they're kind of all in the same position and they can't act as individual lenders and call back their their debt or anything like that. And convertible debt is usually not eligible for EBC tax credits. Now, to contrast that, and it's something that I would recommend to all of you, is a safe, a simple agreement for future equity. There's no magic to it. What it really is it's almost like debt, but there's no interest and no maturity date. What it is, it's an agreement that the investor will get equity in the future when a financing happens, and at that time, that financing will set the valuation for the company. So you might be sitting there saying, I found somebody that will give me $20,000 or $200,000. I don't know what my company's worth, and I don't want to look like I don't know what I'm doing to them. You can offer a safe. Now, it won't bear interest like debt, but you can account for that by offering a discount to what the safe will turn into upon that financing. So if you raise money at $1 a share and you've said, okay, I'm going to give you a 20% discount, then all of a sudden, you know, they're getting a 20% discount to $1, whereas the investors in that future round are paying $1 a share. Now, this is eligible for EBC tax credits and all of that 30% goodness that we talked about, but it's not eligible at the time you make the investment for the safe. It's eligible when the safe turns into the share.
These are really big and happened historically in Silicon Valley. It's the idea with this is it's a one or two page agreement. It allows people to get money in really quickly and it doesn't slow down the business. And there they were finding by the time they'd actually got all their financing document together, like, you know, the opportunity had been lost. So they came up with this way to let's get the money in right now. We'll figure out the terms later. You know, 20% discount to your next financing. Great. Here's the money. And it's a two page document.
Stock options, doing a really quick summary of those just because they do tie into the cap table that we are eventually getting to. You know, a stock option is a right to purchase shares at a predetermined price. Like I mentioned, it incentivizes the team. Very briefly, in Canada, you can issue stock options or grant stock options at below fair market value in certain cases. And so even if you are, to use my example, have raised money at $1 a share, there is examples where you can grant a stock option to your employees, for example, at that cent a share to try to top them up on their aggregate compensation. And the tax, there's positive tax treatment to that. They won't be taxed immediately like employment income. And if you're looking at saying, well, I know I need to have a stock option plan, you know, kind of what are my rough ballparks on how that should be used? You know, if you have a stock option plan that is 20% of your company, let's say that, you know, we have our 8 million founder shares and there's a plan for 2 million, just to use nice round numbers, you know, about what should my 2 million in ungranted stock options be used for? That's kind of a breakdown. Although, again, it's all fluid, and remember that that we're always making sure that we vest our options, protecting the company, and making sure that those options, which are tied to performance, are the company's protected in the case of a non-performance. So we finally got to our cap table. This is going to take kind of a progression at a very high level through a company's lifespan. In our example here, we have our three founders that have subscribed for a total of 6 million shares at our nominal price. And so funds raised, yes, it's $600, but that's not the intention of it. So we have our three, let's just call it three people for 2 million each. And we've convinced our friends and family to actually put in $100,000 for 400,000 shares, and at 25 cents a share. So we've already seen how the impact on share ownership, whereas our founders had 100% of the company, now they only have about 93.75% of the company. And at the bottom left, as you go through the slides, you can track the pre and post money valuation. Pre-money at 25 cents a share, you've convinced people to invest in your company at a value of $1.5 million, 25 cents on 6 million. And the post-money valuation, which is after you actually receive this money, is 1.6 million because you just got 100,000, not the 400 like I put up there. So you've raised 100,000, and now you have a little bit of dry powder to hire some employees and get this thing going. You've decided to add a stock option plan. You've asked your lawyer how large it should be. You came up with 1.5 million shares, or a plan of, but by no means are all of these allocated yet. This is the plan that's been authorized. So now we have our angels, and let's say that, you know, now you've convinced 10, 15 angels to give you $420,000. I'm using nice round numbers on the price per share. So this is at 35 cents a share. And so these angels are now going to have 1.2 million shares, which gives you a total shareholdings of 7.6 million. At 35 cents a share, the pre-money value is 2.24. And one of the things to highlight here is when you convince that angel to pay 35 cents a share, they did not factor in the option plan. Okay, so this is what is called being done on a non-diluted basis. That's going to be important later. And so we see that the founder's ownership interest has already gone way up. Their percentage ownership is obviously being eroded, but as a function of financing activity. So this is a Series A investor. So you've convinced a venture capital firm to give you $1.5 million. They got 3 million shares for that at 50 cents. So now there's 10.6 million shares outstanding. A couple things to note. The VC at this time said, well, we want to make sure that you have enough in your option plan to account for, obviously, this expanding company and the need to use a larger amount of options for a larger amount of people. So we're going to actually make you add another 500,000 options to your pool. The other thing is, yes, we valued your company at $4.8 million, but we've done it on a fully diluted basis, including not only the plan, but the 500,000 options we're going to make you add to it. So does anybody see the issue there? Not only, so you, if you were to go back to your other two founders and say, this venture capital firm just said that we're worth $4.8 million, if you were to quickly do the math, you would come up with a different number than what they're telling you you're getting, because what do I mean by that? Well, if we know that they're going to give you $1.5 million, and we know that they consider your company to be worth $4.8 million, then if you had negotiated to not include your stock option plan, you know, not the 1.5, let alone the additional 500, then they would actually be paying about 63 cents a share, and they would actually only get about 2.4 million shares. And so it's the same money, the same amount of money, 1.5 million, same company value, 4.8 million pre-money. But look at the difference when you start playing around with a little bit more complex concepts, like whether to include equity that has not yet, a convertible equity. And so I think this is one of those areas where, you know, hopefully you have to encounter it, because these are conversations that are occurring when people are about to write you large checks. But certainly as an issue spotting exercise, something to be mindful of especially when there's very experienced, knowledgeable investors that are throwing numbers and concepts around valuing your company to keep in mind. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I would just say when you're doing the term sheet, do the math. You see clients where they're like, oh, they said we should increase our stock option plan from 8% to 12%. And yeah, it seems like a good idea to me. But what they could, in a sense, care less a little bit about that. But by doing it as part of the valuation, they're diluting the existing shareholders rather than the future shareholders. So that's okay. But when you're agreeing to that, know what you're agreeing to.
And then in similar fashion, this could be what it looks like when you have, kind of a Series B VC. Now maybe you've convinced somebody to invest in you at $1 a share. You've thankfully receive $5 million. And so, again, the impact on not only the increased valuation of your company for the founder's ownership interest, but also the pre- and post-money valuation. Again, these are, you know, these are very these can be very complex, and this is by no means a comprehensive look at things, but certainly tells one story in a way that hopefully illustrates the impact on ownership and also the impact on value, and how a company can experience you know, the push and pull of that as it goes through its life cycle. I thought this would be where we got all the questions. No.
Well, we'll probably.
Yeah, we can go to. Yeah. Do you want to do the last slide, or do you want to just go into questions now?
Yeah, there was a request from last year to speak a bit more about commercial agreements, and that can be its own 3 or 2 and a bit hours. What I would say is that, and by commercial agreements, I mean, you know, actually, you know, what are the agreements through which you, you know, engage business partners and customers and things like that, sales services agreements. Just at a very high level, these are so unique as amongst each of them that, you know, the only value add we can add here is there's some high level considerations. Because just like you're a startup, you know, your needs and wants are going to change like your company's going to change. So always make sure that you have very clear termination rights on these agreements. You know, we've seen examples where a startup entered into an agreement that, you know, said that this distributor was going to be the only distributor in all of the United States for the next 3 years, and there's no termination clause. Well, that's, you know, then the relationship went sour, and this poor startup stuck with that. Well, you know, make sure that you can get out of this agreement if it no longer works for you. Make sure that there's, you know, very clear, you know, very clear language around exclusivity in whatever form that takes, and it matches exactly what you're getting. And make sure that, if applicable, who owns what intellectual property is spelled out, you know, extremely clearly in those agreements. But, you know, happy to answer any questions on that afterwards, because those are very large topics.
All right. Q&A, I guess.
So I'm just going to say thank you very much. I'm going to say goodnight to the webcast, but are you guys okay if anyone from the webcast emails you? All good?
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, great. So we'll cut off the webcast. Good night. Otherwise, if you got to go, go. Otherwise, Steve and John will stick around and answer your questions. But thanks for coming, and we'll see you here next week. Thank you.
Thank you.